During the holidays, I finally had some time to try out ChatGPT and see for myself what will be the cause of my future unemployment. After I got my answers to the meaning of life, when Half-Life 3 will be released, and if this project would keep me safe from Rocco's Basilisk, I thought to myself, what is it that I've been unable to do for the past 4 years? That's right, finish a video game project. Since video games are notoriously complex pieces of software to create, I thought it would be an interesting proving ground for ChatGPT. Oh yeah, and we are not using one of these engines to do the heavy lifting for ChatGPT. No. We will be sticking to plain old C++. So let's get started. Okay, not quite what I had in mind. That's more like it. Surprisingly, it only took me a few hours to copy-paste this together, and most of the time was me waiting for ChatGPT's answers or figuring out ways to get around the character limitation. First up, let's ask ChatGPT to open a window and render a sprite to our screen. Immediately it starts blurting out code. It imports STL, a popular cross-platform library for access to low-level hardware APIs, and proceeds to initialize a window and set up a texture for a sprite. I've prepared a C++ project and set up CMake to import all necessary dependencies. Let's copy the code and see if it actually works. And after running the code, we actually see that it opens a window. That's great. But it doesn't render the sprite yet. I also prepared some assets for our game, and the sprite for our player is called player.png. It's a little spaceship. However, the file that ChatGPT tried to load was sprite.bmp, so it's no wonder it didn't work. Let's tell it to load our file instead. It quickly provides us an answer, and after trying the code we get another error. And this one is related to the path the image is actually located in. Since we are trying to load it from a macOS binary, we need to provide a full path to the file. Let's just ask ChatGPT for a solution. And it immediately shows us how to do that. And after copying the solution, we see that it actually renders the sprite now on the screen. Yay! Next, I wanted to know how to get the actual dimensions of the image to set the height and the width of the texture appropriately. And it works. We can actually see the sprite now in its full glory. I also changed the dimensions of the screen to make our screen a little bigger. This next question got me really excited. I asked ChatGPT to create an entity component system, which is a popular and often used software architecture pattern in video games, and it did just that. The code it provided was simple and not over-engineered, so I decided we could make use of it directly. I asked it if it could integrate that answer with our previous window code and also add input handling while we are at it. And wow, not only did it understand to combine our two pieces of software, but it also added an input component to get user input. At this point I was really hooked and wanted to see if the code really works. And it worked. We can now move our player across the screen using the arrow keys. Next I wanted to do some code refactoring. So I asked it to create a render component and a render system to handle the rendering of sprites on the screen. And after copying over the changes, we see that everything still works. I also wanted to change the way that systems get references to the components, and instead of passing it in the update function, just keep a reference in their structs. And now something interesting happened. While doing the refactoring, ChatGPT also simplified the code, and by doing that it actually introduced a bug. I told it that it had made a mistake, and if it could please fix that mistake. And after trying the fix, we were back to normal. Pretty cool. Next I asked it to implement delta timing for our movement system, which is used to achieve frame rate independent rendering. Basically it means that if our game runs on a really fast computer, we don't want our player to become really fast as well. I had to add a speed component to a position update since we now only move our player a tiny fraction every frame. Now we come to one of the most important parts of almost any game, which is the AI. ChatGPT gave me an overview over the different techniques that are usually used to create AI in video games. I decided to go with a state machine and asked it to create an AI system and an AI component that supports that. However, the answer it provided seemed over-engineered for the purposes of our small game. I asked to create something less complex and just told it the rules that I wanted the AI to have instead. I told it that I want the enemy to follow the player around on the screen until it reaches a certain threshold. It quickly came up with a solution, so I started integrating it into our current code. After pulling everything together, we had a small enemy on the screen. The code was still a little buggy, but it took no time to fix it. And now we had an AI that was chasing the player around the screen, a great starting point. What would a space shooter be without laser guns? So I asked ChatGPT to spawn projectiles once the AI is in range of the player. ChatGPT quickly updated the AI system to provide the necessary functionality, and it also suggested to create a projectile system and a projectile component. And while it created a projectile system and a projectile component to store the necessary information of the projectiles, we still didn't have a way to render the projectiles on the screen, so that's what I asked it to do next. Whoops, not kind of what I've expected, but funny nonetheless. Let's ask it to add an attack cooldown for the AI. And the logic it provided in its answer actually created an attack cooldown for our enemy. That's cool. Now I wanted to mix up the player controls a little. Instead of the left and right arrow keys moving our player left and right on the screen, I wanted to introduce a rotation component that rotates our sprite depending on the input. And, well, it actually works, kind of. But we forgot that now we also have to change the way that we calculate our velocity vector. So I asked ChatGPT how to change our velocity based on the direction that we are currently facing. And now, if we change the rotation of our sprite, it also changes our flying direction. Great. Conversely, we want to set the rotation of our enemy sprite depending on where the enemy is facing. And the enemy is always facing towards the player, so that should be very easy to calculate. Well, apparently not as easy as I expected. But that was actually a mistake that I made, where I switched up the X and Y components in the arctangent function. And after eliminating the human error, everything seemed to work fine. Next I asked ChatGPT to also create a shooting system for the player, since we also want to shoot at the enemy. And our shooting system works, but it has similar issues to what we've seen previously. Now the issue here is that we are detecting our key down event for our shoot key, which is the spacebar, in every frame, and we are also reacting to that event for every frame. So what I usually would do in such a case is I would set up a flag in our input component to check if our shoot key has been handled or not. But let's see what ChatGPT comes up with. And the solution that ChatGPT comes up with is actually the same that we would have expected. Additionally to the spacebar flag, it sets up a spacebar pressed flag that gets reset every time we spawn a new projectile in our shooting system. And if we run the game now, we see that even if we press down the spacebar, it only spawns one projectile at a time, which is exactly what we wanted. So to have any meaning for our projectiles, we should probably create a health component. So that's what I asked ChatGPT to do next. I also asked it to do the collision handling between our projectiles and our sprites and reduce the health of the entity that it collides with accordingly. After integrating the new code, we can see that now the projectiles disappear when they hit an entity. And yeah, we must assume for now that the health also gets reduced. So as the next question for ChatGPT, I ask it to actually help me render a health bar so that we can see the health values of our entities on our screen. And after a little back and forth, because I also wanted to render a background of the health bar to just make it look a little nicer, we can see that our previous code actually works, and the projectiles reduce the health of our entities, and the health bar also gets updated accordingly. Pretty cool. Now I want to render some text on the screen once our player's or enemy's health has reached the value of 0. For that, ChatGPT suggests to import the TrueType font library of SDL. It's pretty straightforward to set up. I also add a new component to render the text, and I add some input handling to replay the game once the text appears on the screen. So I would say we have the basic game mechanics now finished for our small game. And the last big part that is missing is sound effects. We know the drill now. We ask ChatGPT how to load sound, and it tells us to use the SDL mixer library. Pretty neat. And that concludes our little project. I added some more sounds and did a little cleanup, and I'm pretty satisfied with the result. When I first heard about ChatGPT and the end of software engineers, I was pretty skeptical. I foolishly believed it would still take decades to have a real impact on the industry. I was obviously wrong. OpenAI has granted us an early view into the future. Considering all I have seen in the past few days, it seems inevitable that the job of the software engineer is about to go through a tectonic shift. We have already reached a point where machines are more skilled in designing software than humans are. I suspect that within a year, most software engineers will be using an AI assistant similar to ChatGPT, and the ones that won't will pretty much be left behind. The only thing that ChatGPT currently lacks is user interface and user experience, but the technology is already there, and things will not stop there. We will create new programming languages that are not aimed to program CPUs and GPUs, but neural network powered AIs instead. In the next years, we will see tools that combine several AI systems to work on different subsets of software systems. We humans will not generate code anymore, and not even do the system design. We will merely steer the AI systems in the direction and supervise their work. If you are interested in these topics, I recommend you to watch Lix Friedman's interview with Andre Kapathy, who led the computer vision department at Tesla for several years. Pretty exciting stuff. What do you think? Let me know in the comments, and if you think this was an interesting video and you would like to see more, leave a like. Thanks.